Welcome to the sixth section on energy balance and obesity. And I'm going to be talking in this section, this short section, about the obesity epidemic. We used to just have an obesity epidemic, or what's been termed an obesity epidemic in the United States, but it's now become a global problem in the last 30 to 40 years. If we look at this data, this goes back to 2008 from the World Health Organization, you can see that in red, there's a prevalence of obesity of more than 30. And that means that 30% of the population is obese. And that means obese and overweight. That means not just overweight, but obese. So remember, that's a BMI of greater than 30. And we look here at the United States, Mexico, parts of South America, Northern Africa, Southern Africa. But even look at the countries now that have an obesity rate of greater than 20%, almost up to 30%. And you can see this is more in the orange, and through here, Australia, South America, Canada. Of course, the obesity rate of less than 10%, you can see a lot of Africa. But even the 10 to 20%, you can see parts of Africa are developing obesity. And we think of these poor third world countries or not the first world or well-developed nations, which we usually associate with obesity, but we're now starting to see obesity develop even in areas of rural China and India. And the idea is not only the standard American diet or the Western diet, the SAD diet, has infiltrated all parts of the world, slowly infiltrating all parts of the world, but also a lot of industrialization has. And so all of the mechanisms that help us conserve our energy have as well. So our lifestyle factors as well as our diet. And at this point, we're seeing it becoming more pervasive, they are now calling it a global epidemic because there are more people who are obese and overnourished than there are undernourished. Of course, one of the problems is you can be overweight or obese and be malnourished because you're getting a lot of the wrong types of foods and not enough of the right types of nutrients. Now, just last summer, so 2013, the summer, the United Nations had announced that Mexico has surpassed the United States as being the fattest nation in the world. So we are no longer number one. We are now second to Mexico. 70% of Mexican citizens are either overweight or obese. And in this slide, what I want to point out is that in 1970, the main causes of death in Mexico were infections, parasites, respiratory illnesses. Today, they're dying of the same diseases that we are, those diseases of affluence, the diseases that are caused in part or associated with nutrition, what we put into our bodies, how we live our life. Heart disease, diabetes, two of the top killers in Mexico. And we know that heart disease and cancer are the top killers in the United States, with diabetes being one of the top. These are diet-related diseases, diet and lifestyle-related diseases. This is a short period of time, 40 years, a little over 40 years. We are looking at a change from how diet and lifestyle have impacted basically health and morbidity and mortality. I like this quote because as we look at this global epidemic, the last 30 to 40 years, and I heard someone say this, I wish I could give them credit for it, but he said, we have not had a global collapse of willpower in the last 30 years. And think about that, because sometimes we look at people who are overweight or obese and we think they're fat and lazy. That's what we have in our head. But we now have a global epidemic. We haven't had, and it's not as if 30 years ago people said, I used to be able to give up that chocolate cake, I had no problem saying no, but now I just can't resist it. I have no more willpower. And that's just not what has happened. Part of this, actually a lot of this, has to do with the types of foods that have made their way to the basically the mainstream populations throughout different countries. The sodas, the packaged food, processed foods, the added sugars, the refined grain products, the processed oils. Those are, we have lost the a lot of the native diets and what we might call our ancestral diets, or the way we used to eat and are now eating this, you know, like I said, the pre-chewed food, the food that has already gone through half the digestive process, where our body doesn't have to do as much work. Remember, this is the type of food that impacts our hormones. It impacts our metabolism. It changes our behaviors. So the food that we eat impacts us, and it's the food that we're exposed to and we're around that changes our hormones, and it changes our behaviors. So I don't want you to leave my class and think that people who are overweight are just fat and lazy, because that's not true. And you might, you know, it might take a lot for you to say no to a certain sweet or a certain type of food, but it might be easier for you because you don't have a hormonal drive or a neurohormonal control that's driving you to desire that food. Not to take credit away from people who make good food choices, but remember there are hormones that do drive our behavior. And so we have to look at the bigger picture, not just the individual, and criticize the individual. When we look at causes of obesity, there are a lot. And this is not by any means an all-inclusive list. So this is a partial list. But some important things that we discussed. Genetics. Remember we talked about the thrifty gene? We talked about, you know, our survival over the past 2.5 million years being in part related to maybe our ability to store food better. Those who survived periods of food scarcity were better able to store food. So now, in the last 100 years, those genes have been more problematic. Hormones. I've talked a lot about the hormone imbalance. We talked about insulin resistance, leptin resistance, how insulin and leptin can control behavior, satiety, and our desire or drive for food. The environment, and this is actually two parts. We didn't talk at all about some of the toxins in our environment that some research is now actually showing to be what we call obesogenic, might actually contribute to obesity. And that research is still coming out, but also our food environment. And it's Kelly Brownell who coined the term the toxic food environment, but that's what we're in. We're in this toxic food environment where we're surrounded by foods that are highly processed, refined, they're devoid of nutrients, and they alter our hormones and alter our metabolism. They change our behaviors. So these types of foods. So we talked a lot about refined carbohydrates, those really highly digestible starch that very easily becomes glucose that will impact insulin. We also talked about all the added sugars, how fructose has that individual effect on obesity, potentially that individual effect on obesity contributes to insulin resistance in the liver, stores fat in the liver, sends it out into the bloodstream. We have a lot of added sugar in foods, a lot of processed grains products that are overconsumed. Remember, foods such as refined carbohydrates don't contribute to satiety the way that fat might contribute to satiety, at least one of the signals. Now, of course, always fat from whole foods, and we talked about good fats and bad fats, but remember, fat can help with satiety, as can protein. Foods with fiber. Fiber increases stretch receptors in the stomach, sends a signal to the brain that you're getting full. Metabolism. We talked about basal metabolic rate, how individual people will have different basal metabolic rates. And part of this is based on genetics, parts based on where you live. Remember that people in Colorado living at a higher elevation in a colder environment are probably going to burn more calories just by where they live. That's probably why they're the least obese state in our nation. And Denver, Boulder are the two basically thinnest cities in the nation, even though their rates have doubled. If you're taller, you're going to burn more because you have a greater surface area. You'll burn more calories. And lastly is socioeconomic class. believe it or not, there are direct correlations between your socioeconomic class and obesity. The lower socioeconomic classes have higher obesity rates. And part of this is their access to food and the amount of money they have to spend on food. You can get a lot of calories for very cheap if you're drinking a big, you know, super gulp soda. Not a lot of nutrients in there. So that is part of the reason these sodas and refined products, cheap processed grain products, have contributed to obesity, because they are cheap. They provide a lot of calories and they don't provide a lot of nutrients. Now, the book goes through a lot of strategies for weight loss. I'm not going to go through those. And the reason is that we've been talking about the right diet this whole semester, and I'm not going to change anything that I've said based on weight loss, because the diet that is healthy for you is the diet that will also help lose weight. And we already went through this, but a lot of it has to do with the types of foods that you are choosing and choosing real whole foods. So despite what you might read as far as percentage of carbohydrates and protein and fat, a different combination might work for you better for losing weight, because people are individual. But it's got to be whole food. If your carbohydrates come in the form of fruits and vegetables and legumes and whole grains, we have meat that is not processed and prepackaged and filled with nitrates. It's not made into a sausage. It kind of looks like a muscle. That is the type of meat that you would want to be eating. Fats, processed fats, trans fats, hydrogenated fats, those are not good fats. But fat, maybe from a grass-fed cow, is probably really good for you, as are fats from fish, fats from flaxseed and walnuts, or omega-3 fatty acids. So when you think about those foods that you're eating, we'll go back to the same thing, same theme over and over again, is you really want to focus on eating real food. And that is the end of our Chapter 9 material.